As we're coming into this new Hebraic year, this new season, one of the things that I think we need to understand is I was reading in John between chapters 14 and 16, and Jesus said this. He said, I've got to go away so that I can send another comforter to you, and he will be with you, and he will dwell in you. Now, that phrase, another comforter, in the Greek is the word paraclete or parakletos. And it's translated helper, comforter, succorer, aid, defense attorney. How many need a defense attorney? Come on. But what's interesting is that when you look that word up in the Aramaic, it comes from a combination of two words. Parak, meaning to end, to finish, or to stop, and leto, which means the curse. Jesus said, I've got to go away so that I can send you a curse breaker, a curse destroyer, and he's going to be with you, and he's going to dwell in you. And I tell you, this is the time that God says, I'm rising as a mighty man of war, and I'm putting a stop to every curse, every hex, every vex, every assignment that's been against your life, and everything the enemy has set inside you to sabotage you from moving forward in this season of time. Now, in the book of Numbers, when Balak hired Balaam to curse the people of God, Balaam said, I can't curse them. I cannot curse these people because the shout of the king is in their midst. So I want us to lift up a shout to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in this place tonight. We shout unto God tonight with a voice of triumph. We shout with a voice of praise. We declare, Jesus, you are Lord over Warrior, Alabama. We decree it tonight. You're rising as a mighty man of war, Lord. We decree it in the spirit, in Jesus' name. Turn to your neighbor and say, we've got victory.
You know, the word for shout in the Old Testament in the Hebrew is the word ruah. And it sounds a little bit like the roar of a lion. So can you just decree over somebody, give them a high five and say, ruah! We loose that breakthrough anointing now in the name of Jesus Christ. Let me tell you, how many know everything looks better in the glory? So turn to somebody and say, wow, you look better already. Amen. You may be seated in the house of the Lord. We're so glad to be here, so excited. Thank you, Nancy, for inviting us. Of course, Pastor Robin, glad to have you be able to get to know you guys a little bit and be able to be blessed here in the house, here in Warrior. And I heard the Lord just say, tell them they've come to the kingdom for such a time as this. How many thought that was the decree over Esther that began to set the stage for her to begin to shift and release a divine reversal in her generation? How many believe God's getting ready to turn some things around? And so we're agreeing with God that we are here having a divine appointment. Whenever there's a divine appointment, you know what else happens? There's always a divine assignment. How many are willing to be on assignment for God and say, whatever it is you want to get done, God, I want to be a part of it in this day and in this generation. I remember many years ago, we were in the nations and we were with Apostle Prophet Dutch Sheets, and he is so powerfully used to bring reformation to our nation in this hour. And I remember he was standing before this crowd of British believers, and he was a little frustrated because they, you know, had that stiff upper lip. They weren't really being stirred and moved like he felt they should. And I remember him just pounding the desk and standing in front of this large crowd and saying, I don't care what you came to do, but I know I am here on assignment and I'm going to fulfill my assignment. It was in his growly prophet days. He's happier now. But I'm telling you what, I took that and I said, you know what? Every time I go somewhere, I want to know what is the assignment and fulfill what heaven has in mind. And how many want to live that way for the Lord? Amen. And so we're going to just believe that God's assignments will be fulfilled and even given out for us to have orders to fulfill for the commander in chief. Amen. And I remember there was a day in Matthew 8, and the Lord's been speaking to me out of that, when Jesus spoke to his disciples and he said this, get in the boat. We're getting ready to cross over to the other side. And you know what? In the Greek, it's not really a divine suggestion. It was a divine command. And he said, get in the boat. And you remember there was this one disciple that said, oh, I'll go wherever you want me to. And then Jesus turned back to him and said something like this. He said, you know, birds have nests and foxes have dens, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. You know what he was saying to them at that moment? You're going to have to begin to move with me. And if you don't have a pioneering spirit inside of you to say, God, I'm not settling. I'm not just going to say, I got what I want. Here's my four walls and I got my door and I've got what I want in my house. No, he's saying, I need some people that are willing to move, as we heard even through the song of the Lord tonight, saying, wherever the wind blows, wherever God wants to go, I'm saying, God, I'm willing to sacrifice all to be that kind of pioneer that went into the West and said, there's a divine destiny I've got to fulfill. And so I'm willing to sacrifice anything and everything in order to accomplish and to fulfill the journey that I am upon. If that's you, lift up your hands toward heaven. Father, I'm agreeing that there's a company, because Jesus said, it said he left the multitudes. He was not happy with just the crowds. He said, I need the remnant that are willing to get in the boat and say, God, we're going there. If you decreed that's where we're called to be, then I'm not holding back. I'm going to be like you and be with you. And I'm going to fulfill my divine destiny. I'm going to fulfill the assignment in my generation. And so, God, here is a remnant to say, we're going to cross over. A remnant that's going to say, we're going to be those that are of a pioneering spirit. We're not settling. We're not just sitting down in Zion. We're standing up and we're moving with the cloud and we're saying, there's the promised land and we're going to get there and we're going to fulfill what you decreed is our blessing. And so, Father, we're moving with you in this hour by the power of your Holy Spirit. Give the Lord a shout of praise, because when you celebrate, you elevate into what God wants to release upon your life. You know what? There was another disciple that kind of said, I want to go. And he said, but wait, I've got to go do something. My father is in that state where he's dying or dead, and I've got to go take care of the estate and take care of things. And Jesus turned and it sounded like he said something mean. He said, forget that. He basically said this. It says in Scripture, he says, let the dead bury their own dead. You know what he was saying at that moment? He's saying, if you hesitate at this moment and let your past familiar things pull you back into whatever it's trying to call you to. Well, we always did it this way. We always had our culture, my family, my region, my whatever says do it this way. And God says, no, you got to cut some ties today and you got to be willing to launch out into the deep. You got to be willing to cross over into the new. I have something for you to do for me and I need for you to move. And so if you hesitate, it may be too late. And so God says, I need a company that is saying, I'm not going to live in dead religion. I'm not going to live in those old dead cultural norms or the traditions of men. I'm cutting free from that and stepping into where God has decreed I'm called to do in this day. And so, Father, I'm saying I'm following you. Give the Lord a shout of agreement for that. Now listen, they began to cross over and they got into the middle of the lake. And what happened? Anybody know? A furious storm arose to the point that some of these seasoned fishermen thought that they were going to die. And you know what? Jesus was in the boat. And was he in the boat? Do you remember? What was wrong? He was asleep, right? He was at peace. He'd been working hard in ministry. He said, I'm kicking back. And so he needed a little rest, and he was heading over, and he was at peace. And yet this furious storm arose that says the boat began to fill up and began to sink. And so they go and wake Jesus up. And say, Jesus, don't you know we're getting ready to die? That's pretty severe, right? That's a bad storm. But I don't think this was any normal storm. The Lord said, that was a demonic storm. Why was it a demonic storm? Well, we know for one thing, when he stood up at the front of the boat and he began to speak, he didn't speak like he was speaking to something, but someone. He was saying, peace, stop, in the name of the Lord Most High. Stop, submit to the will of God is literally what it means. Peace, be still. And all of a sudden, everything changed. But listen, why did the storm arise? Because I think there was this demonic controlling spirit in the territory of the Gadarenes on the other side that knew exactly what Jesus is getting ready to do. And he said, oh, he's asleep. Maybe we can threaten and we can intimidate these disciples. And if we stir up a big enough storm, maybe they'll go back to play it safe and never come over here and deal with us like we know Jesus wants to do. And so it sent this storm. And what I heard the Lord say, that the storm, that part of the storm that we've been going through recently is called COVID-19. And God had been stirring his ecclesia to say, we're crossing over to deal with some demonic controlling spirits that are coming out of the death culture in nations, regions, and in cities and places that we're sent to. And the church was arising. And then this storm came to try to intimidate, to try to shut down. And he said, it's not just, COVID-19 was not just like a virus that's a natural thing that you get infected with. It's more like what tries to get into a computer. A virus that gets into a computer wants to get in there, and what does it want to do? Slow everything up. It wants to cause it to begin to shut down, lock down, and if it can, cause it to have a fatal error, to corrupt the system. And the Lord said it was made up of three things: fear, fatigue, and fatalism. And I would just want to pray for you as we start off tonight, because I'm believing that whatever tried to get into our system to begin to cause things to flicker and to begin to shut down and slow down and try to lock down, God's going to begin to deal. He's the best antivirus program that you've ever seen. You know, the only way you deal with the Antichrist agenda is to get more of the Christ anointing. And so let's agree right now, Father, as an apostle of God, I take the authority granted to me in the name of Jesus, and I come against that foul spirit of intimidation, that foul spirit of fear that comes. Why does fear come? It always comes to control you and to shut you down. But I decree the church is rising up, the church, the ecclesia, the remnant is ready. We're going to cross over, and we're going to begin to do the work that you decreed we're called to do in this generation. And so I break that foul spirit of fear, and I say, no more. You're not stopping us. You're not slowing us down, and you're not hindering our faith. What did Jesus say to his own guys after he rebuked the winds and waves? He said, where is your faith, and why are you so afraid? He was saying, you came to wake me up, but the truth is I needed to wake you up to understand who you really are. You can speak to the storm too. Come on, lift up your hands. Father, I decree, you know, fear is contagious, but you want can be more contagious? Faith. And so we're here in an atmosphere of faith, and we're loosing right now that anointing that destroys every assignment of fear, every assignment that wants to intimidate, whether it's political correctness, whether it's the way the world is operating today to shut us down and shut us up. We say, no way. We're stepping into the breach. We're stepping into the storm. We're stepping in to go to the other side, and we will not be stopped. Jesus is in the boat. He still made a decree. He has not changed his mind. He's going to fulfill what he has decreed. And Lord, as we lift our hands, I decree that our hands will not hang down. Our feet will and knees will not be feeble. Our head will not hang down. We're going to hit the tape running, God. We're going to be at the finish line with you, doing what you've called us to. As the balconies of heaven and all that great cloud of witnesses in Hebrews 12 was looking down, we're going to be ones that have received the baton. The heroes of faith did their part, but we're going to take our assignment. And we're going to run the anchor leg as strong as it needs to be run and hit the tape for the victor's prize. We decree we are a glorious church, and we're going to be used powerfully in these last days. And so, Father, I break every assignment of fatigue, every assignment of weariness. Father, every assignment of long COVID or any other assignment, either soulishly or physically or financially, shake it off. We shake off the fatigue. We shake off the confusion. We shake off that which would try to fatigue us. And we say, no! We will be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. We'll rise up like the wings of eagle, and we will have our strength renewed, and we will begin to fly like never before. And that last one is something called fatalism. What's fatalism? It means, well, you know, que sera, sera, whatever will be, is what has to be. You know, it's the last days. It's been prophesied. You know, the Antichrist is going to rise. This is going to happen. What can we do about it? Listen. I know where in my Bible do I find where it says, well, all right, church, sit down. Just let the enemy take over. No, he says, occupy until I come. It's that I give you power and authority over all the power of the enemy, and the enemy cannot harm you. He decreed my ecclesia will have the keys of the kingdom, and the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. And so until he returns, I'm going to fight with all of my might, and I'm going to say, I'm not backing away. Just say, God, whatever's going to happen. Nope. If it's been prophesied, you'll have a glorious church. If it's been prophesied that you're going to have a people that will have faith, then I'm going to be a part of the remnant. I'm going to be a part of the company. I'm crossing over to the other side. You know, I think the apostles must have looked at their prophecy book in the middle of the storm and thought, when did Jesus talk about a storm like this taking place? And maybe some of us in the middle of COVID thought, who prophesied this? Not too many, there were a few. But I'm telling you what, it wasn't about that. It was about the decree that he spoke and said, you're going with me to the other side. I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. And I will fulfill every word that I release does not return to me. Boys, so lift up your hands one more time. We just decree that there is the ecclesia, a remnant company here in this house and in this region that will rise up, will put a sword in one hand and a trowel in the other, that will be put the word of the Lord in their mouth and begin to press the battle to the full, that we're going over to the other side and dealing with those foul, controlling spirits that have ruled our nation and ruled many places. But Jesus, when you begin to deal with that, all of a sudden, it didn't matter if it's legion, it didn't matter how many there were, they had to go and come down. The giants are coming down in our day. Give the Lord one more shout of praise. Ruah! Hallelujah. Amen.
Could we ask the Bullocks to please come? And we just want to lay our hands on them. Y'all are okay. You can stand, you can sit, whatever you prefer. But we want to just release a word over them before we even get into the word. We want to release a word to them. So stretch your hands out to them, no matter if you're sitting or standing.
How many know if you bless the shepherd, then he will bless the sheep, right? So as we bless them, we're going to see the anointing flow all the way down.
Before we pray, when you talked about in your vision how the Lord brought you in the back gate, I knew exactly what the Lord said. Okay, you weren't too excited that you came in the back gate of heaven. But you know, when we came here tonight, they brought us through the back gate because the back gate had direct access to the sanctuary. And I felt like the Lord says he's giving you direct access to the sanctuary and to the Holy of Holies. Amen. And so, Father, we thank you, Lord, for that amazing, amazing anointing and gift that you're bringing them into, in Jesus' name.
Just stretch your hand out. Let's come in agreement. The Lord says, son, I took you by the hand when you felt like that you had lost everything in the land. And I said, if you look to me, I'll begin to renew you in a way that only I can do. And I said, we're going through the gate, but I'm going to take you through an issue in your own life that you had to lay down and say, it's not about me, God, it's about you. And because you were willing to sacrifice and to lay down your life, I began to pick you up and I said, I'll take you through the fire and you'll go higher. And you will begin to burn bright for me in these last days, and I'll cause you to be a key, and I'll cause you to be a voice, and I made you uniquely that you would fit certain doors and certain hearts and certain places. I'll send you to unique forums, and unique opportunities will begin to unfold for you to be able to declare my glory and my truth and cause there to be a release of signs and wonders, and even you are called to be a sign and a wonder for me, says the Lord, for you will be one that will stand in the gate. You will stand and be a standard, and you will say, this is the way, walk you in it, and you'll say, this is the day that you have to choose, and you'll be one that will bring a dividing at times. For didn't I even say of myself that I came not just to bring peace but to bring a sword? And surely I came to divide even in the heart and divide in the mind away from the things that were filled with death and to bring people into life. And so you're going to be amazed that I will show you a way to move forward. And the Lord says, be not afraid even of the things that will come your way that would feel like the enemy has won or the enemy enemy has done what he can do. For I've already decreed your victory, and I've already surrounded you with a company of angels. And those things that are going to come through will only be so that it might be the things that will test you and try you by the fire. But I also will take you higher, and I also will guard your heart and guard your mind. For surely the enemy had a lot of plans that he thought he could do to try to rob you. But I've decreed that I will work with you in a way that will be a way that will begin to shine light into darkness and begin to cause my church to begin to arise and begin to have hope afresh and anew. And so I have anointed your eyes and have anointed your heart. And the Lord says the two of you will be even a powerful release of that double portion mantle of wisdom and revelation. And the Lord says, even as you move in revelation, my son, your wife will have a gift of wisdom to impart great strength and to bring even a surety to the foundation and cause many to feel even that security that they need so they can launch out into the deep. And so, Father, I decree that mantle, Lord, as you blessed us with a double portion, even as you described in Ephesians 1:17, the spirit of wisdom and revelation, let it be for them as well, that as they co-labor together, it will give a full expression of your heart, and it'll bring a strength to the body, and it will cause ones to stand strong. And I just decree that they will stand, and having done all, they will withstand and stand everything that they need to and be planted in the land and bear great fruit for your kingdom's sake, and that the enemy cannot win, Lord, when you've decreed the victory. And so we agree for that blessing upon their life and upon their family, even some of the secret things in your heart and concern about your family. The Lord says, son and daughter, I've already begun. Even some things that kind of wanted to turn and burn in a certain way, I said, I'm going to begin to put out the fires that need to be put out, and I'm going to begin to turn even in the mind and the heart, and I'm going to even hear your cry, and I'm going to work even at the very issues that even need to align, and I'm going to help you to have that hand and lift them up. I'm going to cause others even at my command to do their part, and they're going to come alongside. And so, Father, I just decree right now, God, that the angels on assignment are coming and that there is a strengthening even as the angels fed Elijah. Lord, let it be in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. And I heard the Lord say, daughter, I want you to know that I have put that heart inside of you like Deborah. For the Lord says, Deborah was a mother in Zion. She carried a prophetic anointing, but she was also a judge that carried the wisdom and the strategy. And the Spirit of the Lord says, daughter, that there in the past have been those that have underestimated you. But the Spirit of the Lord says, daughter, I want you to know that there is a roar coming out of you in this season of time, says God. The Lord says, daughter, there's a roar of my Holy Spirit. And the Lord says, daughter, that you're going to raise up strong believers. You're going to bring them forth out of the mess of their past, says the Lord. You're going to bring them out of the dysfunction, and you're going to raise up a functional army, says the Lord, a functional army that I will raise up even here in Warrior, Alabama. And the Spirit of the Lord says, son and daughter, that even in this season of time, that is your mandate, to raise up the warriors, says the Lord. And I just want to say that as we came off the freeway, we passed the sign at the elementary school that said, be warrior ready. And I heard the Holy Spirit say, this couple will raise up the warriors so that they can be warrior ready. And the Lord says that I will send to you seers, I will send to you psalmists, I will send to you saints, and I will send to you shepherds, says the Lord. And you will raise them up, for this is a season of multiplying. And you will even conduct boot camps, says the Lord, that will help people shift their mentality out of civilian mentality into Holy Ghost warrior mentality, says the Lord. The Lord says that it's been done in the past, and people kind of went off in strange directions. But the Lord says that I took my time grounding you and founding you in my word. The Lord says that I have given you that double-edged sword of the prophetic, says the Lord, but also the wisdom that comes with it. And the Spirit of the Lord says, son and daughter, you will help to raise up my army. And the Lord says, that's why I chose here in Warrior, Alabama. The Lord says, for I have established an open heaven over this place because of your praise. And the Lord says, every place that you go, you have learned how to open the heavens. Now I'm going to give you you strategies how to pull that open heaven into an open earth that will bring dramatic transformation, says the Lord. For yes, you have sensed it, that the body of Christ is moving into a new season, a new war season. And the Lord says, I want you to know, son and daughter, that you're going to help to prepare the warriors for the new war season. For the Lord says that it's going to be a season of crossing over and crossing in, says the Lord, to possess. No longer will the body battle just to survive, but they will battle to possess. And the Lord says that even in this new season of contending, the Lord says that I'm activating prayers and prophetic words that you gave years ago. And the Lord says, my word does not return void. And the Lord says, I will keep my promise even to you and even to this land, declares the Spirit of the Lord. There is a ladder in Warrior, Alabama, where angels are ascending and descending. There's a ladder here, says the Lord, where I've opened the heaven. Now you will pull it down into an open earth and transform this place, says the Lord. You'll break the spirit of poverty. You'll break the spirit of religion. You'll break the occultic stronghold, says the Lord. And the Lord says, you will establish my kingdom, says the Lord of hosts.
Come on, give a shout to the Lord. Hey! Yeah! And I want you to lift your hands. You know, when I was young at 16, my dad was a pioneer in the prophetic, kind of known as the father of the modern day prophetic movement. And I had a word over my life so many times. Just like Elijah, loose to Elisha, you'll receive a double portion mantle of your father. But I really believe that the reality of that is seen in how God has caused my wife and I to be those that co-labor together. And I want to just release that same anointing upon all those tonight that just want to receive it, whether you're married or not. But if your husband or wife is here, take them by the hand. If you're not married, lift up both your hands. And whether you want to be married or not, that there's going to be a co-laborship of apostolic and prophetic ministry. There's going to be a co-laborship of men and women. There's going to be a co-laborship of husbands and wives. So, Father, we lift up our hands just as we heard the word of the Lord. We decree, so let it be. Let the double portion begin to fall upon this house and upon this region. We break every tradition of men, every assignment of division, every assignment they're trying to hinder, and we say no, the double portion will flow, and it will be evident, and it will be seen, and that we will operate on that level, God, even as Elisha was used to change the city. So let it be. With that double portion mantle upon us, let us release that kind of transformation impact in the name of Jesus Christ. Turn to somebody and say, we're going to do it. Amen. The Lord bless you. Just remember, the prophetic is a lot more than information. It's always impartation. So just receive the impartation of heaven for you tonight.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. It's wonderful. Thank you, guys. We love being here. You know, before we came up, I really didn't know much about this place. And I found out that your church is called Church International. And our ministry that's been established through my father-in-law, who's now 89 years old and going strong. How many of you know my father-in-law, Bishop Bill Hamon? Hands all over this place. He's considered to be the father of the modern prophetic movement. And he named the ministry 55 years ago, named it Christian International. So you know what? We call ourselves CI, and you call yourself CI. We have two daughters and a son. They have two daughters and a son. We have a family ministry. You guys have a family. I think that we must be related somehow. So I want to say thank you to our dear friend, Nancy Alcorn, who connected us. She's one of my dearest, dearest friends, and awesome to be here with her as well. Going to jump into the word in just a minute. Let me do this. I have books back there, but I want to give a couple of them out. First of all, I want to give this to Pastor Robin. It's called The Deborah Company, and since I prophesied over you being a Deborah, I actually have a whole book that will help you to understand what that means. Let's give her a wonderful hand. Amen. And the little girl with the humongous voice that was standing over here, Mad, could you come up here for just a second? Run all the way up here. I have a book for you. It's called Dreams and Visions. And I heard the Lord say that he's put a psalmist anointing on you like he put on David. And David heard the sounds of heaven and began to reproduce them in the midst of the earth. And the Lord says that I'm going to put a trumpet to your mouth. And the Lord says that that trumpet will begin to resound prophetic messages. And it will begin to connect people's heart to the heart of God. And the Lord says, daughter, I'm going to move you into a new dimension of revelation. Because I'm going to begin to visit you in the night season. I'm going to give you prophetic dreams. I'm going to give you prophetic visions, says the Lord. And the word revelation means to remove the veil. And I just see the Lord pulling back the veil so that you can begin to see to a greater degree in the realm of the spirit. You've been hearing and you have that knobby prophet anointing that bubbles up, but the Lord says, I want to couple it together with a seer prophet anointing, says the Lord, for I'm putting that double portion upon you. Now, Lord, I loose that double portion on her right now, Father God, to both see and hear and then sing and declare the word of the Lord. Father, I loose that over her in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah.
I heard the Lord saying that he's breaking tonight an assignment of condemnation against your life, that you felt like you would never measure up in some ways, and the enemy has played a game on your mind, but the Lord says, daughter, you're mine, and I love you, and I've already decreed your victory. I've already decreed that you're my beloved, and I want you to know that my arms have already embraced you tight, and so I loose that assignment of love right now that you are now blessing her with, and I say reject and condemnation. You have no place in her life. We shut the door in your face. You will be disgraced, enemy. She's going to be graced. And I speak that increase now from this day forward in Jesus. There's a new peace on you, a new peace upon you. Increase, increase of peace now in Jesus' mighty name. Ho! Thank you, Lord.
Whew. This is how a prophet gives away books, okay? Hallelujah. I also want to give this book, Amber. Come on up here, Amber. And Krista, is that your husband? Your favorite husband? Your best husband? Bring him up here, too. Honey, why don't you come back up here? Do you have... Okay,
he's not here.
Okay. So this is a book that I've written called Discernment. And I felt like when I met you in the back, it reminded me when Kim Clement first came to this country, he called me out of a crowd, and I had three little kids, like below the age of five, hanging around my legs. And he said to me, he said, the Lord says that I've called you to be a watchman, and I've anointed you to see the snake, and I've anointed you to see the wolf. And the Lord said, when I met you in the back, the Lord said, you've got that same watchman anointing over your life. And the Lord says, it's not been a comfortable calling because you see things that you don't want to see and you hear things that you don't want to hear. And the truth is you truly do love people and you truly do hate the devil. But the Lord says, daughter, sometimes you get it mixed up and you want to kill people. And the Lord says, the Lord says, daughter, I want you to know that I am working my grace and my mercy on the inside of you, and there have been times that you've cried out and you've said, God, please take this away from me. I don't want to see what I'm seeing, and I don't like what I'm having to experience. But the Lord says, my daughter, I need you in place. I need the watchman in place, says the Lord. The Lord says that even tonight, I'm uncapping this gift inside of you, says the Lord. You're going to see angels. You're going to see demons. You're going to discern the hearts of men and women, says the Lord. You're going to discern the witches when they come in. And the Lord says, daughter, the strategy isn't cast them out. The strategy is get them saved. And the Lord says, daughter, I want you to know that you're going to see clearly. And the Lord says, daughter, I'm opening up your eyes to see in the realm of the spirit, but I'm also opening up your heart because the enemy played on your mind and just said, you're judgmental, you're critical, you're hard, you're harsh. And the Lord says, I break off of you every lie, every assignment from hell, and I loose to you clear revelation that will cause you to step in to the position. For I will have a watchman company. I will have intercessors in this house to push back the gates of hell. So Lord, we loose this over her life right now, God, and we decree increase in discernment. Increase, God. She will see the snake. She will see the wolf, God, and she will sound the alarm in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. One more area is that when I started operating this way, I got very burdened down with false responsibility. And I feel like the enemy thought, you know, I'm not going to be able to stop her, so I'll just overload her with false responsibility. And you carry the weight of the world on your shoulders sometimes. And I just hear the Lord saying, just like he said to me, I called you to see the snake and see the wolf, not kill the snake and kill the wolf. And that the Lord says that that's your job as a watchman. A watchman doesn't get off the wall and fight all the battles themselves. They sound the alarm so that the army can be mobilized, the body can be mobilized to all fight the enemy together. You're going to find that your revelation is going to go to another level, and you're going to find that your personal strength and your joy is going to go to a new level. So, Father, we loose that over her now in Jesus' name.
What's your husband saying? Robbie. Father, I thank you for Robbie. And I hear the Lord saying, daughter, surely I gave you the right man. And I put even a command upon his life. And he had to lean upon me even in the times when he felt weak. But I put a strength of stability inside of him. And even now, I am fortifying his positioning. And I'm causing him to have a new understanding of determination and knowing how to break through the darkness, know how to break through even the mundane and the things that seem like, why do I have to go through this or that? And I want you to know, son, I've been with you all along. And this is a time that you're going to find me in a new way. And you're going to be one that feels my grace upon your life. And there is a maturity that's coming that's going to cause you to stand alongside this woman in a way that many will see the strength and stability that needs to be there to cause many to be blessed and come underneath the shade of that tree, that you will have roots that go deep and you will have fruit that will be born. And there will be a shade that will come because of your willingness to follow me. And so, Father, I decree unity and strength in the family and a covering of connectedness and a co-laborship and an impartation one to another and an encouragement that will always be there to flow, to uplift the hands of the ones that are kind of hanging down. And I decree that they will be one, and I bless them now in that way in Jesus' name. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise.
Amen. And I want to pray for Krista, and your husband is Austin. Okay, is Krista? Krista, okay. I want to give you this book called Declarations for Breakthrough. It's how to agree with the voice of God. And what the Lord shows me is that the enemy has sought to kill you on more than one occasion. And the Spirit of the Lord says, enough is enough. Enough is enough. We break every assignment from hell. We break every curse, everything that the enemy has sent against her. We decree now, God, the curse is being turned to a blessing. And the Lord says, daughter, I have put fire in your mouth, says the Lord. I have put fire in your mouth, and I put boldness in your soul. The Lord says, you will prophesy. You will win souls. The Lord says, daughter, the devil has sought to kill you because he's terrified of you. Now the Lord says, daughter, I'm adjusting some things within your brain, the circuitry of your brain that has caused certain things to be off in your system. I'm adjusting things within your bloodstream, says the Lord, that the enemy has caused to constantly come out of balance. The Lord says, I am the God of peace, and I am speaking peace to the chaos that the enemy has tried to bring over your body. And the Spirit of the Lord says, daughter, you're going to spend your long life kicking the enemy in the tail. You're going to spend your long life kicking the enemy. And the Lord says, daughter, the enemy will flee. There will be deliverance that will come out of you, says the Lord. You will cast the devil out. You will have great authority in the Spirit, because the enemy thought he could touch you. Now watch and see, says the Lord, how I exact vengeance on him and how I loose you to bring my kingdom into this earth, says the Spirit of the living God.
Oh, now Lord, now Lord, all the way through her system, God. Well, is it Austin? Austin. Father, I thank you for Austin, for the anointing upon his life. And the Lord says, son, I always had my eye upon you. Surely know that I adopted you in because I chose you and I grafted you in so that you could know that my hand has been upon you for good. And I taught you even as a young man about being a son. There were some things that had been done that you had to kind of work through. But I want you to know I'm a good dad, and I'll always oversee and watch over your shoulder, and I'll help you to grow. I'll inspect even the fruit, and I'll say, son, these are the things things that you need to change and the things that you need to do. And you felt like maybe you were going to be okay if God graded on a curve. But the Lord says that's not true. I don't grade on a curve. I'm just going to increase your learning curve, says the Lord. You're going to be amazed at how you grow in grace in this next season. I'm going to teach you even of my word and of my ways. And the combination is going to be great. And you're going to begin to take a rightful place. You'll know how to lead, says the Lord. You will not be behind the curve. You're going to be ahead of the game. I've already decreed that there's not just a catch-up. There's an advancement that you shall begin to do in these days. There's some things that you always kind of denigrated yourself about to say, I can't do this, and this doesn't work for me. But the Lord says, let it go. As I said to my servant Jeremiah, don't say you're too young. Don't say you can't get it done. Don't say it doesn't work for me. Break that assignment and decree that which I have said. I'll put my words in your mouth. I'll put my thoughts in your mind, and I'll begin to cause you to understand how to operate with a rod, even in your hand, to begin to decree the waters will open, to decree that there will be no rain, and there will be rain. There will be an authority in your voice, says the Lord, for you're a warrior, but you're also one that will operate with authority. You will have both dunamis and exousia. You will have power and authority, and you will operate with both very clearly, for there is a governmental mantle upon your life, and you're going to find that as you find your footing, that you're going to grow in confidence and capacity. And so I loose that mantle that's coming now upon his body, upon his mind, and upon his heart, never to be the same again, but to have that deposit inside of him now that will come into maturation, and that he won't have to grasp after. He'll just step into what has been opened as a door for him tonight. Lord, I decree, even as he prays, even as he seeks you, even as he reads the word, is a whole new capacity coming to him, a download into his system, and an upgrade that's going to take him into the new. We decree it now in Jesus' mighty name. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Hallelujah. Bless him.
Wow, wow, wow. Whew. Well, you know, we're in a very, I think, important season right now because, you know, last weekend we entered into the new Hebraic year. Do y'all follow the Hebraic calendar, Rosh Hashanah? Okay. So we're in the 10 days of awe right now, which is really a time of repentance. It's a time of, really when you think repentance, a lot of times we just think it means stop sinning. If you're sinning, stop sinning. It does mean that, okay? But really even more than that, it means change the way you think. And so I think the Lord is removing limitations during this season of time so that we can begin to think the way that he thinks as we come into this new Hebraic season. Those of you that follow the calendar know that this is year 5784, and we focus on the 84. The 80 is the number, is the word in Hebrew, pay. Everybody say pay. And pay means mouth, voice, and sound. Okay, so God is paying attention to what you're saying. Okay, and God is paying attention to the sound that you are creating. How many understand that at Jericho, God listened for a sound? And when he heard the sound, he caused walls to fall down. Amen? And so we are in a time right now, the decade of the pay has everything to do with the sound that's being created. That's why this is one of those places. It's because of the sound that's going up. That's not just a rehearsal of music, but it is a prophetic sound that is every single week in, week out, opening up the heavens so that heaven can come down. Amen? And so in this decade of pay, I think it's very interesting that then the next number is 4, and that is the word dalet, which is the Hebrew for gate or door. Okay, I assume that you guys are already caught up on that, okay? Jesus said, I am the door. In Revelations 3:8, it says that I set an open door before you that no man can close. How many are believing for that open door? Now, here's the thing. When you combine voice and door, what you have is voice-activated doors. We live in a voice-activated society, right? Now, we don't personally have Alexa in our home, but those that do, because I think it's creepy, although they're still listening on our devices no matter what, just to say, a few months back, I was driving along in my car. I had my purse on the floorboard of my car, and I was praying in tongues at the top of my lungs, and out of my purse, Suri says, "I'm sorry, Jane, I don't understand what you're saying." So I kept praying in tongues, and Suri said again, "I'm sorry, I still don't understand what you're saying." I was getting ready for Suri to bust out into tongues and interpretation, okay? But that did not happen. But, you know, we live in a time right now that if you've got certain things in your home, at voice command, you can say, "Adjust the temperature." How many understand our voice can adjust the atmosphere? How many understand you can say, turn the lights on, turn the lights off. You can say lock things up or unlock the doors. How many understand that God has put a voice activation in our mouth to begin to lock things and to begin to unlock things, to begin to loose things and to begin to bind things? And this doesn't come just because we think positive thoughts. It comes because by the anointing of the Holy Spirit, we open our mouths and we begin to speak. Do you realize you can't even get saved without opening your mouth? You shall confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that he raised him from the dead, then you will be saved. So I believe that we're in a season right now of voice-activated doors. So voice-activated opportunities, voice-activated doors of spiritual, supernatural access that I believe that God is giving to us, and that voice-activated opportunity that God is laying before us. I want to read you a scripture out of Isaiah 45, verse 1 through 3, and I believe that this is, I actually wrote about, this is a scripture about Cyrus, who was the great deliverer that after 70 years of Babylonian bondage, God brought Cyrus the Great out of the Medo-Persian Empire. He conquered Babylon, and he set the Jewish captives free, sent them back to their land and said, "Rebuild your land, rebuild your city, rebuild the temple." And I believe that we are in a Cyrus season right now. I have a book on that in the back that I wrote like 23 years ago. And I don't really preach on it that much, but I really felt like the Lord said, this is the season that God is reigniting a Cyrus anointing for this nation, and I believe for his church. So it says, thus says the Lord, verse 1 of Isaiah 45, thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held. Now that word anointed is actually the word Messiah. How many understand that Cyrus was not the Messiah, but I believe he was a type for us of who Jesus was when Jesus came to earth to set us free. But I believe he's also a type and a shadow of what it is we are to do and what we are to be as the church, as the ecclesia of the living God. Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held. Listen to what his assignment is going to be, because I believe that it is the assignment of this warrior generation that God is raising up. This is his assignment. To subdue nations before him and loose the armor of kings. Let me say this, is that I believe in this season we are going to see kings come off their thrones. We're going to see some thrones topple in the nations during this next season of time. I believe we're going to see it in this nation. I believe we're going to see it in cities. I believe we're going to see it in regions. I believe that even things that have been long-standing systems that have been in place, I believe are going to topple in this season as we loose the armor of kings. And then it says to open before him, not just a door, but a double door. Everybody say double door. So that the gates will not be shut. I'm telling you, we're coming into a season of access, not just with the heavens. God's going to open the heavens, but he's also going to open gates in this earth realm. And the gates are where the decisions for the city are made. The decisions for the nation are made. So God's, yes, opening heavenly access, but he's also bringing that access down into the earth. He says, so that the gates will not be shut, I will go before you. Listen to God's promise. And make the crooked places straight. I will break in pieces the gates of bronze and cut the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness. Everybody say treasures of darkness. Now, most of the time we think that this just refers to finances, but I want you to understand in the Hebrew, this phrase, treasures of darkness, actually speaks of armories of weapons. Now, understand, we are not talking about natural weapons, carnal weapons, okay? We are talking about spiritual weapons that have the power to destroy spiritual strongholds. And so what they would do in ancient Babylon is whenever they conquered a nation, they would gather all the weapons and all the wealth, which is the hidden riches of secret places, and they would bury it in these huge underground armories. And that's how they protected it. As a matter of fact, when we went into Iraq, because Iraq today is Babylon of yesterday, you know that they found huge vaults of underground weapons and huge amounts of wealth that were buried in the ground. And I hear the Lord saying, not only am I going to give you spiritual weapons, I'm going to give you upgraded spiritual weapons. You understand that from decade to decade, the United States military upgrades their weapons so that we have a greater capacity to take out the enemy. And I hear the Lord saying that he is giving us upgraded capacities to deal with spiritual darkness, upgraded capacities of spiritual weapons that are going to help us fight this battle with greater precision and greater accuracy to take the enemy out where he is in laying ambushments for us. And by the way, he'll also give us the hidden riches of secret places, which is every bit of finances that we need to do whatever it is that God has called you to do and called you to be. Amen? Isaiah 45 verse 8 says, rain down you heavens from above and let the skies pour down righteousness. That, my friends, is an open heaven. But then it says this, let the earth open. I don't know about you, but I'm no longer satisfied to talk about, to sing about, to pray about an open heaven until we see an open heaven start manifesting in an open earth. You know what that means? That means that God's kingdom will come. His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It says that salvation will begin to spring up. How many are believing for this great last days harvest, this last great last days revival, a great awakening that is unlike anything that we have ever seen before? Amen? I believe that we're living in this day and in this hour, and God's saying, I'm opening up the double doors before my people. Now, in the middle of 2020, before the election cycle happened that fall, I think it was August, the beginning of August of 2020, the Lord, we were in morning prayer before our church service that morning, and the Lord spoke three things to me. And he said this, he said, number one, he said, tell the people of God that chaos is getting ready to increase. Yay. What a great encouraging word. So wait, I'm not done. He said, number two, but then tell them that I am going to use chaos to strip the covering off of corruption, off of hidden backroom deals, off of the things that are being done in secret that are sabotaging the destiny of a nation. I'm going to use chaos to do that. And the third thing he said to me was, then tell them the God of peace is rising. He said it three times. The God of peace is rising. The God of peace is rising. And of course, that comes from Romans 16:20, when it says the God of peace will soon crush Satan underneath your feet. And I believe that we've been in this process since that time. How many believe I'm a true prophet that chaos increased? How many believe that we're also in a season that God is actually beginning to bring exposure to the corruption? And I believe that the God of peace is rising for the United States of America, and the God of peace is arising for his church, not just in this nation, but around the earth. Now, when the Lord said that to me, I thought of the scripture in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, when it talks about the names of the Messiah that was to come, that his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, and of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end. And that phrase, Prince of Peace, since God said, I'm the God of peace and I'm going to rise for you, that phrase, Prince of Peace, is very interesting in the Hebrew, because the word for prince does not, it's the word sar, and it does not mean one that sits on a throne and wears a crown and waves at the crowd. That is not what prince means. Here's what it means. One who wrestles, one who wars, one who governs, and one who rules. How many understand Jesus is rising as the Prince of Peace that wrestles, that wars, that governs, and that rules? And then the word peace we know is the word shalom. Turn to your neighbor and say shalom. Shalom, we all know, means peace. It means prosperity, wholeness, completion, to have favor with God, to have favor with men. But you know what's interesting is that the week that the Lord spoke that to me, we ended up on a Zoom with one of our Bible college professors from years ago. We've been married 42 years, so this was 44 years ago. And you know what he said? He said, it's so interesting that you're telling me this. He said, because this week I met with some Hebraic scholars, and they were talking about this word shalom. And they said, we all know what the word shalom means. They said, but what the Hebraic scholars do is that they look at each letter that forms a word, and each letter has a word picture associated with it. So they said, if you look at the four Hebrew letters that comprise the word shalom, they say that the deeper meaning of the word shalom is this: peace comes when you destroy the authority of chaos. And so if you want to understand what our assignment is, we have an assignment as the ecclesia to rise up and, with the God of peace fighting for us, to destroy the authority of chaos. How many believe that the God of peace is rising? I believe that this year is going to be marked by crooked places being made straight. It is going to be a year of contending. You know what that means? It means a year of fighting. You feel like, well, then what was last year? Yeah, right, okay. We're going to fight on a different level, okay? We're going to fight in a different arena this year, because as I prophesied over the Bullocks, I believe that the Lord has said that rather than just fighting to survive, God's bringing us into a time of battling to possess. And you know, when we're talking about doors, we understand that the Red Sea became a supernatural door that led the children of Israel out of Egypt. As a matter of fact, the Lord said this to them. He said, you're looking at something that's impossible. You guys understand, they didn't have a Bible that told them about God parting a Red Sea. They didn't know how to pray, God part the Red Sea. That had never been done. That was not in their paradigm, right? All they saw was the Red Sea in front of them and Pharaoh's armies coming down on them. They had no idea how God could get them out of the situation they were in. I'm telling you, God is going to do unusual deliverances this year. God is going to open up unusual doors this year. And let me just say, I think there are things that we don't even know how to pray for because there's no pattern for it. Amen? And yet the Red Sea became a door, and God said to them, the enemies that you see today, you're never going to see again. How many believe that God could bring you through a door that the enemies that have been dogging your track in this last season, you're never going to see them again? But you know, that wasn't the last crossing that they did, because what they then did, they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. We could talk about that, because I think the church has done some of that. But then God parted the Jordan 40 years later, and the Jordan became a door. You know what it was a door to? Warfare. But it was a door to possessing the land. How many say, I'm willing to fight to possess my land? I'm willing to fight to possess my promise. I'm willing to fight to lay hold of my destiny. I'm willing to fight to take back my nation. Because America shall be saved. How many believe that God will do that for us? Amen? Now, one of the things that the Lord said to me about this season of time is that he gave me the scripture out of Hosea chapter 2, verse 13, that will mark this next Hebraic year. And Hosea 2:13 says this, I will give you the valley of Achor for a door of hope. What was the valley of Achor? The valley of Achor was where Achan sinned against God. And remember, God, he took the accursed thing and God had to judge him. So the valley of Achor actually means the valley of trouble, the valley of disaster, the valley of calamity. And I believe in this season of time, we need to understand that there is a shaking that is coming to our land. I had a vision last year, I think it was, and I saw the Lion of Judah standing off on the Atlantic Ocean, big, huge Lion of Judah, about the size of the New England states, standing off the New England states, and he began to roar. And where his voice hit the nation was from about New York City down to Washington, D.C. And that was the first place to be hit by the roar of the lion. And it began to shake. And then the entire nation started to shake. And to be honest, when I saw it, it fear gripped my heart. And the Lord said, yes, a shaking is coming, but tell the people of God not to be afraid, because the shaking is going to be their making. Now, as the shaking started happening, I saw like a cloud or like a film over America. I saw this cloud or this film begin to roll back, and it was like the things that needed to be seen were being seen clearly. And I saw truth begin to spring up where there was nothing but lies and false narratives. The Lord said the roar of the Lion of Judah was beginning to disseminate across the land. And as it shook, I even saw people in the media, they couldn't help themselves, they had to tell the truth. And actually, since that happened, I've actually watched it, that you see people in front of the cameras, and all of a sudden they say something, you can see on their face like, I wasn't supposed to say that. I just believe we're going to see more and more of that as the spirit of truth begins to rise up in the midst of the lie. And I think it's Joel chapter 3, verse 15 or 16, and it talks about the roar of the Lion of Judah, and it says the heavens and the earth will shake, but the Lord will be a shelter for his people. And what that word shelter means, and it's also translated hope, how many understand we're in a season of hope right now? The shaking is going to be part of what brings the hope, but it says that the Lord will be a shelter or the hope of his people. And this is what the word hope or shelter means in Hebrew. It means he will bring protection from the storm, protection from calamity, and protection from falsehoods. Isn't that interesting? And that's the season I believe that we're in right now. That's why God's raising an army that knows how to pray, an army that knows the power of worship, an army that understands how to prophesy. And I heard the Lord say that he's going to turn the valley of Achor into a door of hope. Isaiah actually says that the valley of Achor became known as a resting place for the flock. How many know that you can rest and you can war at the same time? Amen. And so in this season of time, the Lord said to me, he said, tell my people that I'm going to give them victory in the valley. Now, we all like the mountaintop experience, right? We all want to go up to the mountain. We all want to have the mountaintop experience. That's the place of victory. That's the place of overcoming. That's the place of being able to see far distances. But I want to say to you that though the valley becomes the place of trial, it becomes the place of, at times, tribulation and difficulty, it is in the valley that the fruit is grown. And so I believe that God's going to give you victory in your own personal valley, but I believe that God's going to give us victory in our corporate valley. So I began to study in the scripture about valleys, and I found that the valleys were quite often the places where they confronted the giants. Just travel with me for just a minute. Exodus 17, it's the first time that Israel ever gathered as an army. And they had just come out of Egypt, and they were coming across the land. And there was a tribe there called the Amalekites. And the Amalekites, their name literally means to plunder. How many understand the enemy's been plundering? He's been robbing. He's been stealing. And that's what their name means. And they came and they stood up against Israel and they said, you can't come this way. And so Israel organized as an army in the valley of Rephidim. And this is the place where Moses stood up on the mountain with his rod and Joshua was down in the valley with his sword. Understand that this next season is going to be marked by intergenerational connection in battle. Let me say that again. It's going to be marked by intergenerational connection. This is an intergenerational ministry. Okay? A family ministry. Let's say it that way. You know, in our family, on any given Sunday, we've got four generations on the platform. Four. His dad, 89. Our generation, our children's generation, our daughter and son-in-law, our pastors in our church, and our daughter prophesies like a house of fire. She goes to Mercy with us to prophesy over the girls. And our granddaughter's now 16 years old. She's a worship leader at our church. So we've got four generations. How many understand it's not going to be a single generation? It's going to be multi-generational victory. Amen? And when we learn to come together multi-generationally, let me tell you what's going to happen. We're going to break the yoke of the robber. We're going to break the yoke of robbery, the thief that comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And we're going to begin to turn some things back. And we're going to begin to cause robbery to turn into recovery. We're going to begin to see a season of divine recovery. But things have to shake first. Turn to your neighbor and say, they got to shake first. So when they shake, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Isaiah 28, 5 and 6 says, in that day, I want you to say in this day, the Lord of hosts will be for a crown of glory and a diadem of beauty to the remnant of his people, for a spirit of justice. I believe God's going to rise up as a spirit of justice this year. A spirit of justice to him who sits in judgment and for strength to those who turn the battle at the gate. I want you to lift up your hands. Father, I decree strength over this house and over all those that are watching. God, that word strength means force, might, ability. God, that you are releasing force, might, and ability upon your people, God, that we can turn the battle at the gate in Jesus' name. Give the Lord a shout. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 16:9 says this, for a great and effectual door has opened to me. How many are believing that God's going to open a great and effectual door? Oh, but wait, I got to read you the rest of that scripture. It says, and there are many adversaries. How many still want a door to open for you? Okay. Kind of like good news, bad news. It's like the pastor that got up in front of his congregation and he said, listen, guys, I got to talk to you about something. We've got a huge hole in our sanctuary roof. It's going to cost $50,000 to fix it. And everybody went, ugh. He said, no, but wait, I've got good news and I've got bad news. He said, the good news is we've already got all the money that we need to fix the leak. And everybody cheered, yay. He said, but the bad news is that money is in your pockets, okay? So understand there's a huge and effectual door, but there will be many adversaries. And we can't let it back us up. We can't let it intimidate us. We can't let it shut us up and shut us down. Listen, they fought that battle. Then David fought the battle with Goliath in the Valley of Elah. And there were 40 days of intimidation. How many understand? A lot of what's gone on has been for the enemy to bring an intimidation upon this nation, to bring an intimidation upon righteousness, to shut us up, to shut us down, and to win the battle. Right before January 4th, I'll tell you, right before January 6th, we had an intercession time at our church on January the 4th, and I heard the Lord clearly say this. He said, tell my people, I'm up to something. I leaned in thinking God was going to tell me what he was up to, but he did not. But I knew that some things were getting ready to happen, and what God was saying is, I need my people to trust me. How many believe that God heard our prayers? How many believe God's got a plan for this nation? God's up to something. God's up to something. So we have to understand that, okay? So here in the story of David and Goliath, David's in this valley. He goes to visit his brothers, and he's in the Valley of Elah, and he hears this intimidator out there, and everybody's cringing back. See, this is why God's looking for real warriors with the spirit of David upon them. And so David said, listen, I'll go. I'll answer the call. The Lord gave me a word a few months ago, and he said, I'm issuing a call to arms to my people. That means you got to come out of your civilian life and put on your warrior's clothes. Okay? And so David said, I'm going to do that. I'll go out, and I'll take out Goliath. So he goes out onto the Valley of Elah battlefield, and Goliath looks at him, and it says he cursed David by his gods. How do you understand that there's a voice that's out there pretty much every time you turn on the television that is speaking curses by their God? Now, I'll tell you that the battle is threefold right now. Number one, our battle is, in this nation, is who is being worshipped. And they're cursing us by their gods. You know what their religion is? Wokeism. It is a religion that is built on control through the narrative of climate change. These are their doctrines. Gender ideology and all kinds of other crazy stuff. These are their doctrines. And the Lord said to me last week, I think we were praying last week, and the Lord said to me, it is more dangerous and more violent than Sharia law. It is a religion. And the question is, who is being worshipped? The second thing is, who's making the laws? That's what the battle's over. Who's making the laws? Who's being worshipped? Who's making the laws? That's what the elections are about. Who's making the laws? Who's setting the future course and destiny of our nation? And the third thing is, who's controlling the supply lines? This is the battle, guys. We got to get up for it, okay? So Goliath cursed David by his gods. And he said, who is this pipsqueak of a boy coming out to fight me? Listen, then Goliath began to prophesy to David. Do you know that the devil prophesies? Goliath prophesied to David. He said, this day I'm going to feed your flesh to the birds of the air. Come on, that was a prophecy. Do you know that the devil's been prophesying over America? The devil's been prophesying against the church. The devil's been prophesying and sending lies against you and your family. And I'm telling you, when the devil prophesies, we got to be like David and we got to rise up and start prophesying right back. Come on, David stood up and he said, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that you would defy the armies of the living God? He said, you come at me with a sword and a spear and a javelin, but I come at you in the name of the Lord of hosts, whom you have defied. This day, I'm going to take your head from you. This day, I'm going to feed your flesh to the birds of the air so that all the world may know that there is a God in Israel. We got to understand that there is a prophetic word God has put in your mouth, and you got to let it fly. Why do you think that there's been so much that has stirred to try to shut the mouth of prophets? Because prophets and prophetic people are the answer to the lies and the demonic prophecies of the enemy against our land. We got to prophesy. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. Jesus said, well, in the last days, I'll pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. How many sons do we have? How many daughters do we have? If you're confused, don't come see me at the end. Go see your pastor. How many know that includes everybody? Pastor said no. Okay. One of the most powerful weapons is the weapon of the prophetic word that will bring victory in our valley. We go to Mercy Ministries several times a year, Mercy Multiplied, with founder and president Nancy Alcorn, plus one of my best friends in the world. And you know what we found? Is we found that the voice of the Lord, Isaiah 30, 31 says this, the voice of the Lord shatters the enemy. What a word. Come on, if this is a season of voice activation, let me just say, your miracle is voice activated. Your breakthrough is voice activated. Come on, the things that God, your destiny is voice activated. And one of the ways that we activate our voice is by prophesying. So we go into Mercy and we prophesy over these young women. We don't know anything about them except that they're there. And God always gives us a key. And the prophetic is like a key that will unlock the hardest hearts. And I could go off and I could spend the next hour telling you miracle after miracle after miracle that we've seen with the prophetic. But let me just say this. We prophesied over this one girl one time, and she had just come into the program. She had a very, like, angry, angry demeanor, angry look on her face. I was up teaching, and she kept rolling her eyes, which really builds your faith. And I said to her, Can I just minister to you? And she goes, whatever. Yay, okay. So we called her up, and she kind of cocked her hip, you know, her hand on her hip, and kind of looked at me straight in the eyes and just kind of like, show me what you got. And so I just shut my eyes, and I zeroed in to hear the Lord, and the Lord said this. He said, my daughter, you are not forgotten. You are not forgotten. He said it three times. You are not forgotten. And the third time the Lord said it to her, she just broke fell to the floor and just started weeping and weeping. And I continued to prophesy over her about some of the stuff in her past, about some of the process in her present. And then God began to speak to her about her future. And she just wept and cried through the whole prophetic word. And at the end, she got up and she said to me later, she said, you know, she said, I want you to understand why what you said, God said, meant so much to me. Because she was a different, after when I got done prophesying to her, instead of being angry, she threw her arms around me and hugged me. And she said this, she said, when you said, God said, I'm not forgotten, she said, this is why it meant so much to me. And she rolled up her sleeve and she had right here on her forearm, she had taken a knife and carved the word forgotten. And it was deeply scarred into her as a decree over her life. We didn't know that. I don't think the counselors even knew that. Nancy sure didn't know that. And yet God knew it. And God said, you are not forgotten. And at that moment, you know what happened? Jesus was made real. You know what? God has put his word in your mouth. God has anointed you to prophesy, not just prophesying to the wind. We can do that as well, but we can prophesy. We can bring the word of the Lord to people. We don't have to say, yay, thus saith the Lord. Okay, be sensitive of your surroundings. Look at your neighbor and say, don't be weird. Okay, because we can deliver the word of the Lord in such a way that no matter where you are, you have the power to bring life. And that word may be just the word that helps the person to come out of their valley and to come to their mountaintop. Amen. God wants to give us strategies to have victory in the valley. It's going to be a valley year. I believe that there's going to be lots of fruit grown this year. There's going to be lots of battles, but there's going to be lots of victories. Remember the battle of Jehoshaphat in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And I believe that if you'll go verse by verse in chapter 20 from 2020 to 2021 to 2022, you kind of see where we're at step by step in this decade. But I will tell you this, is that it starts out with Jehoshaphat being surrounded and outnumbered and seemingly overpowered by his enemy. How many know that if you just look in the natural, it looks hopeless? But I'm telling you, our God is never hopeless. Our God is never helpless. And because we have relationship with him, neither are we. God knows how to bring victory in the valley. God always knows how to bring a strategy for breakthrough. So the prophet spoke, and Jehoshaphat heard the word of the Lord, and he sent the worshipers out first. We all know the story. Praise the Lord, for his mercy endures forever. You know, they call that the Valley of Jehoshaphat. How many think it was a valley? But you know where they ended up at the end of that chapter? They ended up in the Valley of Barakah. You know what the Valley of Barakah means? The Valley of Blessing. See, I think that for too long the church has battled and battled and battled and then not stopped to reap the spoil. The Valley of Barakah was the Valley of Spoils. Come on, I believe that this is going to be a year where God's going to take us just out of that valley of battling, 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 and he's going to bring us also into the valley of blessing where we start reaping the spoils. What are the spoils? Well, they're finances. Well, they're provision, but they're also your prodigal children coming home to the Lord. They're also your prodigal family members beginning to wake up to the purposes of God. It's also those members of your life that are in your life who have blinders over them, that have grown cynical and hurt and have abandoned the church. And I'm telling you what, that's better than money. It's also money, but it's better than money. I believe that we're living in a day right now where God is saying, I'm taking my church just out of that battling place into a place where you're going to start reaping the spoils of your battle. You're going to see the tangible results of your breakthrough. I believe as a nation that there's a battle that we must wage. That's why God's speaking about awakening. It's more than just revival. It's more than just revival. Let me say, revivals come and revivals go. God doesn't want just another revival. He wants an awakening. In the second great awakening, Charles Finney said this. He said, a revival changes the heart of a man, but an awakening changes the heart of a nation. Help me believe that God wants to send an awakening to the United States of America. Amen? One more valley I want to talk about. Before we do that, let me just say this. My husband and I, we do a conference every year in Hawaii. Everybody say, oh, I know, that's very sad. I actually grew up in Hawaii, so we love going back, and we minister there on Oahu and on Maui, and we just got back from that. And so years ago, we found that if we didn't go in a few days early, that all we saw was the inside of a church, the inside of our hotel room, and the inside of our eyelids, okay? That's all that we ever got to see. So we decided we'd start going in a few days early to see the islands and to have some fun. But I don't know what it is about going over to Hawaii. My husband decides that I am a mountain climber. I'm not going to ask, do I look like a mountain climber? Because I think I would be insulted by the answer, the overwhelming answer. But my husband decides that we're going to go climb these mountains. We hiked Diamond Head. Has anybody ever hiked Diamond Head? It is exhausting, okay? It is like a bazillion steps that are straight up. Okay, I'm not hiker girl, okay? We also hiked Cocoa Head, which anybody that knows what Cocoa Head is, it's a mountain that goes straight up. I think he's trying to kill me, okay? So a few years back, I decided, I said, babe, can we just, like, do an easy hike? I'm all for hiking, but can we, like, do something that's more my speed? And he's like, okay. So we found this valley called Manoa Valley. And Manoa Valley is tucked back in the mountains on the island of Oahu, and it goes back to this beautiful waterfall. And so it's supposed to take about 45 minutes in and 45 minutes back. And so we started out at about, I don't know, 4:30, 4:45 in the afternoon. The sun wasn't going down till about 7 or 7:30 at that time of year. And so we started out and felt we had plenty of time. So instead of 45 minutes, it probably took us more like an hour and 15 minutes because my husband believes if you don't document everything every 10 steps with a picture, then it didn't really actually happen. How many have one in your family that is that way, okay? I am not that person, but my husband does document everything with pictures, okay? So it was an hour and a half before we got in. We took our shoes off, put our feet in the water, and then it was time to go back, and it was probably a good 5:30, maybe 6 o'clock by the time we started heading back, still thinking we've got plenty of time. When I learned my first lesson about the valley, and it is this, it gets darker in the valley quicker than it gets darker on the beach. And I will tell you this, darkness fell very, very quickly on that trail in the valley. I want you to understand this is the season that we're in. Don't let the darkness frighten you because Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1 through 3 tells us, arise, shine, for your light has come. Darkness will cover the earth, but the glory will rise on you. Lift your hands up and say, the glory's going to rise on me. But suddenly, we were on a trail. Now, let me describe this trail to you. It was an older trail, not the one that's there now. But it was an older trail with rocks and roots, and you had to make your way through the trees. And at one point, there's a 30-foot ravine that you could slide down if you step wrong. And so we're coming back, and it was muddy. It had rained, and it was very muddy. So we're coming back, and it gets very dark. And you know what happened when it got very dark and I couldn't see my way? I stopped. My husband's like, babe, we can't spend the night here. I'm like, why not? I don't understand why not. He's like, come on, babe, we got to go. And I'm like, I can't see my hand. I can't see my feet. I can't see the path. We need help. We can't move forward. How many understand when darkness falls, what the enemy wants to do is get the church to stop in its tracks? And that's what the enemy's trying to do. He's trying to put fear and intimidation so that we do not move forward along the path in the valley because of the darkness. But as we stood there in the darkness and I refused to move, my husband found out just how stubborn I was. Don't say anything. We stood there in the dark, and all of a sudden, revelation came. We had iPhones in our back pocket. But this was a number of years ago, and we had not updated our phone for several years, so they were pitiful old iPhones that did not have a flashlight app. Somebody younger said, they made those? Yes, dear. But you know what we did? We stood there in the middle of the darkness, and we connected to the cloud, and we downloaded light. Understand this, when darkness falls and you can't see your way forward, what you need to do is stop, connect to heaven, and let God download revelation to you. Let him download light to you that will begin to light your path. Your word will be a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path so that we can begin to move forward. So we downloaded a flashlight app. But I will tell you, it was a pitiful flashlight app. It was only a little tiny pinprick of light. But here's where I learned my next lesson. A little bit of light drives out a whole lot of darkness. I hope you're logging this, because this is what we'll live. God's going to give us the light that we need. And sometimes it will enable us to just move forward a little bit. But here's what happened. We start moving forward. We're moving slow, but now we can see where we're going. Okay, we're moving. I'm a happy girl. We can see where we're going. We know we're not going to fall down the deep ravine. We know we're not going to die. Look at your neighbor and say, you're not going to die. When all of a sudden, everybody say suddenly, out of the woods, out of nowhere, come these two Hawaiian maybe angels. And they're trucking along, and they've got big flashlights strapped to their heads. And they're moving down the trail. And they come up to us, and each of them have a backpack. And they said, it looks like you can use some help. How many know that God will send angels to help us? And they reach into their backpacks, and they pull out these giant flashlights and hand each of us a giant flashlight, and then they take off down the trail, and we couldn't see them anymore. And we both stood there with these flashlights going, did that really happen? How many understand over this next year in our valley, when we're walking through our place of the valley of hope, everybody say the valley of hope. As we're walking through that place of the valley, God is going to send angels down to intercept us, to interact with us, to bring help and assistance for us along our path. As we're opening up our mouth, as we're decreeing the word, as we're saying what God says, I'll send angels down because they hearken to my words. This is going to be a phenomenal year. An exciting year. And God's going to send angels to help us. Listen, we're not going to get weird. We're not going to worship angels. We're not going to become best friends with angels. Come on, we're not going to do any of the squirrely stuff that's out there about angels, but we are going to receive the assistance of angels. You know, Jesus was in a valley. It was the Kidron Valley when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane. And you know what he was praying for? He wasn't just praying about going to the cross. He was praying about you and I. And he sweated blood. He was battling. He was fighting the giants. He was fighting the enemy's strategies into the future destiny of his people. He bore our sickness. He bore our grief. He carried our sorrows. Not just when he went to the cross, but it started there in the valley, in the Garden of Gethsemane. You've got a champion. that's already fought for you. You've got a champion that's already won a victory for you. We're not fighting alone, God sending angel armies, but we need to understand that he's already fought for us. He just needs us to get in alignment with the victory that he's already brought for us. Amen? I want to pray something. How many are a part of this house? Most of you. Something that the Lord said is that this is going to be a year of fighting giants. I know y'all don't look very excited about that. Let me just say this. Joshua and Caleb had the right attitude about the giants. Yeah, that's right. They said, why are y'all so freaked out about giants? We eat giants for our bread. But one of the giants that we've battled this year as a family, and I just, this wasn't originally in my notes, and I felt like maybe this was something I needed to revisit tonight, was that there was a giant. She wasn't classified as a giant, but in the spirit, she rose up against God's people. Let me tell you what happened. Short version was last year, December 25th, Christmas Day. I'm so glad that we had this amazing word about a great Christmas. Because we had a crazy Christmas last year. We decided to take our whole family, children and grandchildren. We have 14 of us in our family, 3 children and 7 grandchildren, and their spouses, and then us. There was 14 of us getting on a plane Christmas morning. And our granddaughter, who's 12 years old, she suffered from rolling seizures, one right after the next, between the flight from Atlanta to Denver. It was pretty distressing. When we landed in Denver, she thought she was 5 years old. She didn't recognize anybody in her family. She didn't even really know who she was. She didn't know where she was. It was very distressing. They had to come on the airplane and medically evacuate her off the airplane and take her to the hospital from the tarmac. She spent 3 days in the hospital, and then they came up to join us, and we had a fabulous vacation time together, wonderful time. Getting on the plane to come home, on New Year's Day, Brielle's mom, our daughter, Tiffany, who comes with me to Mercy, was getting on the plane, and she suffered from a grand mal seizure, which, let me just say, nobody in our family had ever had seizures before, ever. She had a grand mal seizure that lasted over 5 minutes. She eventually stopped breathing, and we watched her die in the aisle of an airplane while we were boarding the plane. And we had to call her back to life. And let me just say this. We began to pray. There was just a few people that had boarded the plane, and I said, everybody pray. There was a little Catholic family over here that went. Everybody began to pray. Flight attendants were doubled over sobbing because they knew what had just happened. And her 9-year-old son said in a very loud voice, Jesus, I believe you are a miracle-working God. Come and do a miracle for my mommy. And when he prayed that prayer, life came back into our daughter and she began to breathe. Resurrection life came into her. It was probably one of the most traumatic things we've ever been through, is having to raise our daughter from the dead. I could go the rest of my life and not ever have to do that. We flew home and Tiffany was taken to the hospital. She was medically evacuated from the plane, but we had to fly home, and they came home 2 days later. We brought Brielle home, the 12-year-old that had had the seizures the week before, and the day after, on January the 1st of this year, she was walking with her Aunt Crystal and her brother. And her brother was off. The powerful one that raised his mother from the dead was getting in trouble. He's a Peter, okay? He was getting in trouble. And his Aunt Crystal said, come on, JJ. You know, things are not going the best for us these days. You know, don't get yourself into trouble like that. And We don't want you to get hurt. And Brielle, the 12-year-old, she turned to her Aunt Crystal and she goes, oh, Aunt Crystal, that is so yesterday. That is so last year. She said, we are not those people anymore. How many know we just need to make a brand new start sometimes, you know? But I'll tell you what happened in our family is that a couple weeks later, his sister was in a near-fatal car accident. And a couple weeks after that, his father fell and broke his kneecap. He's still strong, going strong in ministry. We had four generations hit in 4 weeks. And I can remember being on the platform on a Sunday morning. You know, we'd been praying and praying, but I was just like, what in the world? And the Lord said, well, this is an Athaliah assignment. So any of you that know who Athaliah was, 1 Kings 11, she was the daughter of Jezebel and Ahab. How many know this is not good? And her son became king, and when her son was killed in battle, she rose up and she seized the throne. And to make sure that she wasn't challenged for the throne, she killed all her other children and all her other grandchildren. It was an assignment against generations. Not just any generations. These were David's descendants. And you see, the promise had come that God would bring the Messiah through the lineage of David. And Athaliah thought she had wiped out the entire generation, but she missed one. His name was Joash, and he was a baby, and he got secreted away until he was 7 years old, at which time they crowned him king. You know what Joash means? It means fire of God. How many believe that God is releasing his fire to overthrow Athaliah? I want you to stand to your feet if you don't mind, because here's what Athaliah's name means. And it's a sign generationally. You may understand that this is coming against you. It may feel like it's coming against your generations. One of the reasons that I felt to share this tonight was because this morning, my 86-year-old mother, who has never had a seizure before, had a seizure this morning in Birmingham. And I'm like, I'm on to you, devil. I'm on to you. She's fine. She's out of the hospital. She's doing great. Doctors are scratching their heads. They don't know what happened. But this is what Athaliah's name means. It means affliction, constriction, and compression. Affliction means to afflict you with mental or bodily pain, to deliver a blow. Something physical, something mental or emotional. Has anybody here been through any of that in the last few months? Don't raise your hand if it's not you, but if it is you, raise your hand. Constriction means it wants to choke the life out of you, like a python spirit. You know what? We're going across the door, and you know what? In Ezekiel chapter 47, it talks about how the priest goes and he stands in the threshold of the gate and worships. That word threshold, that we all know that word threshold, but in the Hebrew, it is rooted in the word python. You know, they say in Africa that pythons will lay across the doorway, and when their victim steps across a doorway, they will spring up and wrap them up. Some of you are trying to go across a doorway already. You've tried to cross a doorway, and you feel like you've encountered some resistance. Who is that? You feel like a constriction. Maybe you even feel it physically. You feel like you can't breathe. You feel like your voice is being choked out. You feel like physically you're not able to breathe the way that you should. Who is that here, okay? And the third thing is compression, which basically means to slow the growth and development of and to shrink. The enemy's resisting you to try to push you back and cause your forward advancement to be stopped. Who here feels like that's been you? Okay. So if you raise your hand for any of those things, I want you just to come down to this front area. And we're going to do something together as a body, because I just felt like the Lord spoke to me and said there's been an assignment against this house, that as God's issuing a call to arms for the warriors to rise up in this house. They have met all kinds of hell on the path, and the Lord just says enough is enough. You guys have personally dealt with so much stuff. I don't even know you, and I don't know your story, but I know that you've dealt with so much stuff. That's what's made you overcomers. But the enemy has kept coming. I want you to know everybody that we talked about is doing great, okay? His dad stopped traveling because his kneecap was broken, but you know what he's doing? He's 89 years old. You know what he's doing? Every single day, he's Zooming to Africa, Zooming to Asia, Zooming to Australia, Zooming here, Zooming there. He feels like he's Zooming around the world from the comfort of his own armchair, okay? And he's delivering the word of the Lord to presidents and kings and nations and leaders. And let me just say this. There is a promise from the word that says the curse will be turned to a blessing for you. So we're going to take authority over this assignment. Let me just say, when it's this many people, it's not just you. Okay? How many believe we can break a curse? How many believe that we can begin to lift this off, and everything the enemy has brought a curse, God will bring restoration. So I want you to lift your hands all over this place. Let's lift our hands.
As you lift your hands, we're going to come in agreement for God to begin to move on your behalf. You know, my sister had her pelvis broken, her three of her vertebrae, the thoracic vertebrae broken off, and her ribs and all this. But she's fully recovered, getting around fine, just fine. My dad's fully recovered, getting around. My kids and grandkids are doing great. So it says there can be weapons formed, but they're not going to prosper. They're not going to fulfill what they were sent to do. Father, we lift up our hands to you, and we come in agreement right now that every assignment of affliction, every assignment of restriction, every assignment that the enemy has loosed against us and our generations, we stand united as one, and we make that sound that says, even now we're penetrating into the second heavens, and we're loosing the word against that assignment. We say, Athaliah, you're coming down, and your assignment has been discovered, and we shut your mouth, and we shut down your power, and we say no more. In the name of Jesus Christ, we decree the victory is found there, and we loose that anointing that destroys what you have tried to do, and we decree right now that we're shutting up the gate of hell, and we say no more against our generation, against our family, against our future. We decree every robbing spirit, every constricting spirit, every assignment that has come to afflict us, we say, back off, move out, get out of our way. We're stepping into the new. We're going through the door, and we're going to accomplish all that God has decreed. Give a shout of victory. Oh, Jesus. Hallelujah.
You guys stay put for just a second. This young man with the Adidas shirt on. Yes, what's your name? Daniel. Spirit of the Lord says, son, I want you to know that I have put an anointing upon you at your age, says the Lord, to step into a whole new spiritual dimension. And you've been feeling the stirring of the Spirit, and you've been feeling the zeal of the Lord upon your life. And the Lord says that the enemy's come, he's tempted, he's tested, he's knocked at your door. And the Lord says, son, sometimes the enemy gets in your ear and talks to you about your failures. But the Lord says, son, I want you to know I'm really proud of you. I'm really proud of you because you're overcoming, says the Lord. I'm really proud of you because the Lord says you've kept moving forward. And some days you feel like you take a step back in the wrong direction. But the Lord says, son, you're still facing me, and you're still facing your destiny and your purpose. And the Spirit of the Lord says, son, I want you to know that I'm wrapping my arms around you, says the Lord. The Lord says you're not a disappointment. The Lord says, son, you haven't failed me. The Lord says you're in your process of growing. And just like your namesake Daniel, he went through a process of being prepared. The Lord says, son, I want you to know I'm preparing you now, and I'm putting a spirit of excellence upon you that is preparing you for the destiny and purpose of God. And the Lord says, not only was Daniel prepared in secular things, but Daniel was prepared in understanding mysteries, in interpreting dreams, and being able to move past the realm of the natural into the realm of the supernatural. So the Lord says, son, lift your hands up and know that I am baptizing you fresh and anew in my Holy Spirit. tonight, says the Lord. I'm giving you power, I'm giving you authority, and I'm setting you on a course of destiny that the Lord says, from this night forward, you will never be the same, says the Spirit of the Lord. Thank the Lord for that. Amen. This gentleman with the orange Hawaiian shirt on, yes? The Lord says, son, I want you to know my gifts and callings are without repentance. And I want you to know, son, that I have called you to stand up against the spirit of religion. And the Lord says, in times past, religion tried to kill you. It tried to kill your faith. It tried to bring such discouragement upon you that you almost wanted to walk away and not come back. But the Spirit of the Lord says, I want you to know, just like I said to Esther, I brought you to the kingdom for such a time is this. And I want you to know that the things, the callings that I spoke to you, the giftings that I put in you years ago, I'm bringing them back into focus, says the Lord. And the Lord says, you're going to understand to a greater dimension the calling that's upon your life. You're going to understand that your mouth is going to be filled with my word and your hands are going to be filled with my power. The Lord says, son, you're going to lay hands on the sick. Is this your wife standing next to you? The Lord says, son and daughter, I want you to know that you've gone through some heartbreaking valleys already, says the Lord. You've walked through some things that you just didn't understand. You walked through some things that were filled your lives with question marks, and yet you've served me. And the Lord says, son and daughter, I want you to know that I'm going to turn question marks into exclamation points, and I'm going to begin to show up in a way that you've never seen me show up before, says the Lord. You've been faithful to me. Watch and see how I'm faithful to you, and watch and see how I fill your mouths with a testimony, says the Lord, that will absolutely shame the devil. The Lord says that this is a new season for you. Take a giant step forward and step through the door, says the Lord, of your new day. Go literally step forward into your new day, says the Lord, because I'm moving your whole family into a new expression of my love and encountering me, says the Lord.
Hallelujah. And this couple over here, what's your names? Are you guys together? Married? Yeah. Yeah. To each other? Okay, no. Shut your hands out to them. What's your names?
My name's Nathan. This is Caitlin.
Nathan and Caitlin. I just hear the Lord saying, son and daughter, I want you to know I have watched you, and I have been there even when it felt like it's dark and you couldn't see. I want you to know my presence still came and began to sustain you. And the Lord says, I've called you to be ones that know how to persevere. That means when you face your fears, you're going to be able to stand and withstand the plans of the enemy. And the Lord says, I've helped you even in this season. And there's been an assignment of grief that hit your heart and that tried to take you back into a place to try to think about things that wouldn't work out for you. But the Lord says, just because you step back from the door doesn't mean I can't open it afresh and anew, because I'm the God of the second chance, and I'm the God that wants to even open up things to you in this day that you're going to have faith for. And so the Lord says, I'm depositing within you. Somebody close to him, just lay your hands on him, right, and in him. And God's depositing courage in you. God's depositing courage in you. God's depositing courage. And you're going to find that there's a confidence that's coming in this season where you felt so fragile and you felt like I failed. I break that assignment from hell and that a condemnation of the enemy, and I decree that God's even speaking a new name over you. God's speaking a new way forward for you to be able to see that God's going to help you in this season. That word of failure that you felt, and even where you thought you were debilitated, God says, I'm going to release my abilities. Where you thought that you didn't have the capacity, God says, I'm expanding you in this hour. And so I just decree, God, success. Like you said to Joshua, that you'll cause everything that you put their hand to by faith in you to begin to see that release. And so I bless him and I say, increase now, come forth speedily in the name of Jesus. The Lord says, you're going to sow good seed, you're going to sow in right seasons, and you're going to see increase to the things that you do by faith that are acts of obedience. And so God, give them faith and courage to do the work that you decreed is theirs. And Father, that they're going to have a lineage, they're going to have a release in themselves to see the children and the blessing that you want to bring through them in every form and fashion. And so I lose faith inside of them now to receive in Jesus' mighty name. Come on, give the Lord a hand clap. When you celebrate, you elevate into what God has decreed. Are you guys together? What are your names?
Caitlin.
Hunter? Hunter. Father, I thank you for Caitlin and Hunter, and I just see the hand of the Lord has been mightily upon you. You have chosen into some things when you could have opted out. You said, God, I don't want to, and I will not. In fact, you took a stand recently to say, God, we're going to believe it your way. And there's some things you've done by faith. And I just see the Lord says you're going to have a journey of faith over this next year that you're going to see, even as you walk through some things that will try to be contrary, you're going to be an overcomer. And that people are going to look at you and say, I don't know how you're doing what you're doing. And you're going to just say, I don't either. I just know my God. And he comes through for us in these amazing ways. In fact, your budget has been constrictive, and you just kind of made it the best you can, but you've been learning in that process stewardship, and you've been learning about some issues that you have had even from your past that are trying to come into your present, and there's a familiar spirit that wants to restrict you, but I just see you saying no more, and you're breaking off the lid, and you're going to say, I serve a limitless God. And I see, brother, the Lord says there's ingenuity inside of you that has not yet been tapped into, and there's even a capacity that you don't understand about yourself that God's getting ready to open up your heart. And the Lord says, I open your heart and your mind. You'll be amazed that the doors will open right. And the Lord says, now lift up your hands because I want to help you with favor. And so, God, I just decree favor and grace will begin to come into his heart, and then it will begin to expand through his hand. And that, Lord, you're going to bless the work of his hand. There's some things that have been robbed from him, but I decree it's coming back sevenfold. God, that the things that the enemy thought he could do now are going to boomerang back upon the enemy's head. And, Father, I decree, even as they co-labor, can you take hands together if you don't mind for a moment? Father, I come in agreement with their unity. There's some things that says when our prayers are in agreement as husband and wife, God hears them in a special way. And I just see you coming to the altar and presenting your case to the Lord and bringing a seed and just saying these are the things that we're believing for. And God's going to give you a testimony. God's going to show you how he works in that realm of the spirit that touches the earth and the ground that you're upon. And God says, do you guys have a home? God's going to bring a blessing upon your home in a new way, but he's also going to give you faith for the increase that you've already kind of said in your mind. But the Lord says, be particular, be detailed, speak out what you're believing for, and he will answer your prayers in due season. And, you know, we sowed for a house for how many years, honey? To maybe 15. I don't say you have to be 15 years, but we sowed for a long time. We live in a, you know, when you live in a trailer home, you call it a mobile home. When you move out, it's a trailer. So anyhow, we lived with our kids a long time. We have a nice house today. But we sowed by faith, and we begin to describe and say, God, this is what we're believing for. God did miracles. I don't have time to tell you now, but he did an amazing miracle for us to even have the home that we have today. And so, God, I just agree with their faith right now that you're going to bring increase. They're expanding their heart as they're expanding their faith, and you're going to open up even greater ways for them to be blessed. And they're going to see that they're, even as it says in Scripture, a good man makes an inheritance for his children. God, you're going to cause them to have not just enough, but more than enough, and they're going to be blessed so that they can be a blessing the way you've called them to. I put your canopy of favor and your canopy of protection. The robber, we put notice out now. We say the robber will be caught. The robber will not have a way in. The pockets are not going to have holes in them. That it's going to find that budget is going to be met and more in the name of Jesus Christ. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise.
I want everybody to turn towards the sound man. Father, we bless. Wave your hand at me, sound man. Sound guy. We bless the sound man. You know, most of the time, the only time you see a sound man is when something goes wrong. Right? So we're going to all just wave at him for just a second. We love you, sound man. Okay, and the Spirit of the Lord says, son, I want you to know that you're coming into your own personal time of the valley of Barakah. Because the Lord says, son, you've been in a little bit of a valley, and the Lord says you've been blessing those that have cursed you, and you've been doing good to those that despitefully used you. And the Lord said, but what you don't realize, says the Lord, is by doing those proper spiritual principles, you've been setting yourself up for a new season of promotion. And the Lord says, son, promotion does not come from man. It doesn't come from the right and the left, but it comes from the Lord. And the Lord says, son, this year, you're going to walk through a gate of promotion. You're going to go through another door, says the Lord, that's taking the limits off where you've been. And the Spirit of the Lord says, I want you to know the first thing I'm doing is I'm taking the limits off in your heart, for I've actually given you a gift of faith that has learned to speak to mountains of opposition and see mountains of opposition move, says the Lord. And you've learned to be one, says the Lord, that stays in proper spiritual alignment even when all hell is breaking loose. And I tested you and I tried your heart, says the Lord, like the word of the Lord tried Joseph. But the Lord said, son, did I not bring Joseph into the fullness of purpose and plan? And though you feel like you've almost been betrayed by your brothers, and even though you went through a season of time when you got robbed from and lied against, the Spirit of the Lord says, son, I'm taking you out of the pit into the palace, says the Lord. I'm going to bring you into your season of blessing, your season of promotion. And the Lord says, son, I'm activating the brilliance in your mind to another level, says the Lord. The Lord says, technologically, you're going to understand things. Spiritually, you're going to understand things. Relationally, you're going to understand things on a whole new level, says the Lord, because you've blessed me by your heart of obedience. Now watch the blessing of heaven rain down upon you, says God, and prepare the way for you to advance into your next season. And your family members that have been looking at you, shaking their head, going, what is he doing? He's gone crazy. The Lord says, I'm going to show them by my blessing coming upon you, says the Lord, that I'm a true God and that I've heard your prayers and that my favor is resting upon you. Father, we bless this man now in Jesus' name.
You know, a few years back, we had something that happened in our area. We live in Panhandle, Florida, near between Destin and Panama City Beach. And a few years ago, we had Hurricane Michael. And I don't know if you watched that one at all, but it was headed straight for us. And half an hour, we're still staying and praying and decreeing. And it shifted, and it missed us, but it hit Panama City in a major way. And so we became a place of refuge and just sending in all kinds of goods and things into that devastated area. But one of our churches that we're related with actually was in Callaway and took the eye of Hurricane Michael, which actually was a Cat 5 plus, 165 mile an hour sustained winds. And it was 215 gusts, and it was the third strongest storm to ever hit the United States. So it was a major storm. It hit. And they took the eye of Hurricane Michael. You can see on the satellite their church in the middle of the eye. I went over the next day and I started checking it out, and their brand new sanctuary had no damage. Yeah. The other part of the older sanctuary, now the youth room, had two roofs. The top roof got taken off. Well, they had to put a new roof on, but they were able to renovate their building and pay off their building with the insurance claim. So God turned what was meant for evil for good. But Pastor Robert, a good friend of ours, got this word in the midst of it. It says in the Old Testament, if somebody steals your lamb or somebody steals your land, they have to pay back at least seven times, you know, twice or seven times, right? Yeah. And the word there for restore, they have to restore it back to you, is the word shalem. And they looked at the root of that in the Hebrew, and this is what it means: more than before and better than before. So I want you to lift up your hands right now. Let's come in agreement. Father, I decree for every person here. I decree for this house of Church International. I decree over this land and warrior, whatever's been stolen, whatever's been attacked, whatever's tried to be robbed. Father, we decree shalom in the name of Jesus, that whatever has been lost is going to be regained and restored more than before and better than before, and that law and that principle and that truth is going to work in an amazing way for each one, even in this season, because it is your decree from heaven and it is our agreement with heaven into our earth that these things are taking place. So find somebody around you, give them a high five and say, shalom to you. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Shalom. Shalom over this house. Shalom to the Bullocks. Amen. I have one last person I want to minister to, this pretty lady here. Tell me your name.
Kayla.
Stretch your hands out towards Kayla. Father, we just bless Kayla right now. We thank you, Father God, for the anointing that rests upon this woman. And the Spirit of the Lord says, daughter, you know how to walk in that double portion anointing by watching and seeing in the spirit, but also watching in the natural, the things that need to be seen. And the Lord says, daughter, that I have put a gatekeeper anointing upon you, and you're going to find the prophetic release and the prophetic anointing, prophetic dreams, prophetic visions, just an overwhelming sense of knowing that which is going on around about you. And the Lord says, daughter, in this last season, you felt like the enemy kind of came and pulled the wool over your eyes. And the Lord says that you saw there was an attack that came that you didn't see coming. And the Lord says, daughter, that you felt a little sense of frustration about that because the enemy brought tremendous grief to your family in the midst of that time. But the Spirit of the Lord says, daughter, I want you to know I'm bringing you in to your shalom season, says the Lord. You are going to personally, you and your husband are going to enter in to that season of experiencing more than before and better than before. But the Lord says, I'm breaking grief off of you. I'm breaking disappointment off of you. And I'm breaking the accuser's words that said you should have seen it coming. The devil is a liar and his pants are on fire. And the Lord says, daughter, I want you to know that I am going to cause a great seer anointing and ability to come upon you, says the Lord. And the Lord says, daughter, you're going to live your life to make the devil pay. And you're going to extend my kingdom and you're going to extend my hand. And the Lord says, daughter, my decree over you and your house is shalom, be restored in the fullness, says the Spirit of the Lord. Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise? Hallelujah. We're going to turn it back over to whoever it is we're turning it over to. God bless you guys. Thanks so much for coming out on a Friday night.